Good morning. How are we all this morning? Yeah, everyone survived the storm? Good, good. If you're not a local here in Port Rush, if you're up here on holiday and visiting with us, I just want to introduce myself. My name's Lewis. I'm not a member here, nor am I the minister here. So don't be worrying, you can come back next week and it'll be much better. My name's Lewis McKelvey. The official title is I'm an accredited preacher with PCI. What that means is I've received a wee bit of training about preaching, but most of my learning has come from doing it. I'm a member of Ballysally Presbyterian Church, and I want to extend a very warm welcome to you here today. Thank yous for welcoming me, and we're going to worship God together. I think sometimes we can put the Easter story into a box. We can dull it down to just that one weekend of the year. But I want to take some time today, and before we start with our opening praise, I want to read out that resurrection story. Let this sink into your hearts. But on the first day of the week at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day rise." And they remembered his words. Returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. The story of Easter, of what happened that 2,000 years ago, is the reason that we're here today. We are here because Jesus has risen from the dead. What an amazing truth. What an incredible story that hope is restored through the death and resurrection of Jesus. So as we come today, let us set our hearts on those things. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for the resurrection. God, as we come today, we pray that you would help us to understand, Lord. Father, I pray that it would be like new words in our ears, that it would sink deep into our hearts and would cause our feet and hands to move into action. Father, would you be with us today? Would we meet with the true and living God? And would you teach us? Amen. We're going to stand to sing our first item of praise. It is the hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. We are praising the risen Savior, the King of all kings.
Thank you.
Let's come before that, the Father in prayer. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Crown him the Son of God before the worlds began. Crown him the Lord of life who triumphed o'er the grave. And crown him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit. Father God, we thank you that we are here today, Lord. We thank you for the blessings you give us, the blessing of life, of breath in our lungs, Lord. We thank you for the world around us. And as we look out, as we are set in this beautiful part of the world, Lord, we look out around us and we can see how mighty you are, Lord. When we look at the winds and the waves and the vastness of it, we can just see how big you are, Lord. Father, we thank you that you are the creator of all things, Lord. That as you spoke, light came to be. You gave us the sun and moon to govern the day and night. You separated the waters from the heavens, Lord. You gave us land. You filled this earth with animals, from the biggest whale to the smallest insect. And Father, we thank you that you created us. We thank you that in the story of creation, without your breath, we are just dust. Father, would that sink into our hearts? Would we understand the dependence that we have on you, Lord? Would we understand that without you, we are nothing? Father God, we in that creation story, we see perfection. And that beautiful image of this incredible garden, Lord, where you provided for our every need, and yet we still sinned. We bought into the lie. We bought into the lie that we might know better than you. And God, that's something we still do today, Lord. We convince ourselves that if we were in control, we would do a far better job, Lord, and we are sorry for that. We're sorry for when we sin against you and others, Lord. We're sorry that we say things that we shouldn't. We think things that we shouldn't. And when there's times when we should do things and we say things, we don't stand up and do it. We remain silent. Father, we're sorry. And we celebrate the incredible truth that when we come to you and we confess our sins, you are able and just to forgive, Lord. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, Lord. We thank you that in that creation story in Genesis 3, when it looks like the whole world is cursed, you set hope. You tell us that there is a Savior, that there is a redemption story, a plan that you have set in motion whereby we can come back to you, Lord. Father God, we thank you for the stories of the Old Testament and how they point to you, Lord. We thank you for the Passover lamb in Exodus, Lord. We thank you that it points towards Jesus, the once and for all sacrificial lamb. We thank you for the story of David who killed Goliath with his own weapon. We thank you for Jesus who defeated death by dying on the cross and rising again, using death's own weapon against it. We thank you for the story of Jonah, a prophet who at first ran away but came to tell people the good news of a saving God, a faithful God. Father God, we thank you that Jesus came and he never ran away, but he was told us of a saving God and modeled it for us. All these stories pointing to the truer and better Adam, the once and for all sacrifice, and the King of all kings. Father God, as we meet here today, I pray that it wouldn't just be a meeting of your church, a gathering of your church, but we would meet with the living God. As we open the scriptures, we would meet with you. And Father, that our lives would be changed. We would go out of here with a spring in our step, with a new song in our mouths, and with a determination to tell everyone about this risen Savior. Father, would you be with us today? And would all glory be given to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Boys and girls, do you just want to come down to the front? Yeah? I've got a few things to show you, so come on down to the front. Good morning. I'm not coming to you, I'm coming to get my box, don't worry. How are we all? Yeah, well, there's a few more coming down. Who's back to school tomorrow? No? Oh, that's brilliant. When he's back to school? Thursday? Wow. Who else? Is anyone off longer than that? When are you back to school? Tuesday? Anyone else? No? No. Now, as I said, I'm not from this church, so you might have to help me out. Hands up if you come to this church normally. There's a few, okay? And hands up if you're here on holidays. Yeah? Have you had a good holiday? You have been here on holiday? Yeah? Aren't you jealous of them who get to experience this all year round? Yeah? Wee clue, it's not always this nice. So it's not. In the winter, it's freezing. So it is. Boys and girls, my name is Lewis, okay? I am 27 years old. Isn't that old? Yeah? I want to tell you a few. No, it's not old, thank you. I want to tell you a few things about me, okay? I love rugby. I hurt my shoulder playing rugby. I love rugby. My favorite thing in the past year was the World Cup until Ireland lost, and then I was very upset. You can ask Caitlin about it because I was at a wedding and refused to dance. I love Jesus. I'm a Christian. I follow Jesus. I love Jesus. I work in Portrush, and I play guitar. I love playing guitar, and I love music. Hands up if you love music. Yeah? Who's your favorite artist? Any Taylor Swift fans? Any Taylor Swift fans? Yeah? Yeah, we've got a few Taylor Swift fans. Well, who's your favorite artist? You don't know? What's your favorite song? What do you think? Anyone know? No? Well, I'm going to tell you a few things. One of the things I've started doing is I've started collecting things from concerts I have been to, okay? So I'm going to show you a few, all right? We'll start off with the least likely to be known, okay? This here, I got to go to a concert a few weeks ago, okay? It's a guy called Oliver Anthony. No one's going to know him. But he came the whole way from America and played a concert in Belfast. And I decided I would try my luck on. And I would get a signed set list. So if you look at that, that's all the songs he did. And then he's been able to sign it. Okay? Now, I know what you're thinking. That's probably not worth much. But there's people selling them on eBay for about £500. Pretend Caitlin didn't hear that, my fiancé. What about this one? Does anyone know what this is? Now, I'll take it out of the packaging for you. This is how much I love yous. Okay. Does anyone know what this is? This probably looks really funny. So it does. Let's see if we can get it out. Oh, look, it's yellow. I haven't had this out of the packaging yet. What's that? Does anyone, what is it? A record CD? Well, you're half right. It's a record, so it is. A CD is a wee bit smaller than a disc. Does anyone know what you do with this? What do you think? Yeah, so you put it on a music player. It uses a tiny wee needle, and it goes round everything. And that means that the music will come out, and you will be able to hear. I got this at a concert in December. And look, what's that? A signature. This is a man called Voy Vance, and he's one of my favorite musicians of all time, and I was able to get a signed record off him. I haven't checked this one on eBay, so I'm not quite sure what it's worth, but I heard he did it at every concert, so it's probably not worth that much. And finally, this one you might actually know who it is, okay? But there's no signature, so I can't really prove to you, but I can show you the photos later on if you come. I went to Cardiff last June, and this was a concert I've been wanting to see for years. Has anyone ever heard of Coldplay? Yeah, you've heard of Coldplay. Have you heard of Coldplay? Okay, do you know the movie Sing? Yeah? Do you know the gorilla and he sings the song Sky Full of Stars? Coldplay wrote that song. Like, they're really famous. This is the actual drumstick which Will from Coldplay played with in Cardiff. Isn't that cool? The only thing is, I can't prove it. So it's probably not worth that much. If I had been able to get a signature or someone to actually say or write down it actually was his, maybe it'd be worth something. But something that I'm going to put up in my new home, and I'm going to be able to share that story with people. I love music. I also love airplanes. So I used to come up to the air show every year, and I loved meeting people who were famous. Later on, I'm going to be speaking to the adults about a story in the Bible of a man named Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus was a man who was blind. He couldn't work because he was blind. He didn't get help because back in that day, the government didn't do that sort of thing. So he had to beg at the side of the street. And imagine it. It's a bit like Portrush on a really busy day. There's all these people, and they're walking down the street, and he hears all this hustle and bustle and commotion. He can't see anything, but he hears it. He hears people saying, "Look, that's him. That's the man. That's the man who does all those miracles. That's Jesus." And Bartimaeus goes, "Oh, that's the man who I've heard all these stories about. That is Jesus, the man who does all these miracles and heals." And so Bartimaeus starts to shout out, "Jesus! Son of David, Jesus!" And amongst all that crowd, do you think Jesus heard him? Yeah. He did. You're exactly right. Jesus heard him and said, "Bartimaeus, come to me." Imagine Bartimaeus, who's blind, getting up and trying to run through the crowd to get to Jesus, bumping into everyone. And then Jesus says something really strange to Bartimaeus. He says, "Your sins are forgiven." And Jesus heals him. Jesus heals Bartimaeus. He gives Bartimaeus his sight back. He does this incredible miracle. And then Bartimaeus gets up and follows Jesus. Jesus is powerful. The stories in the Bible are true. All those miracles are true. And even more importantly, those miracles can still happen. They might not look the same way as they always did, but Jesus still can heal people. When I say that, I don't always mean that he heals people who are really, really physically sick, but we've all got a sickness. That sickness is called sin. And sin is really, really bad. It means that we can't be with God. And the good part of the story is that Jesus can heal that sin. Last week we celebrated Easter, and because of Easter, we can be healed from the sickness of sin. Isn't that a great story? Isn't that an amazing truth? Exactly. Doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. Doesn't matter what you look like. Jesus can still heal. Can we pray? Yeah, can I pray with you and pray for you? Yeah, let's pray. I put my hands together because you don't have to, but it stops me fidgeting. I close my eyes so I don't get distracted, because I get distracted easy. But let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you so much for this story of Bartimaeus, this blind man who was healed by you, Lord. Father, we thank you that he got up and followed you. God, we're sorry for all the sin we've done. We're sorry for the sickness that is in our lives. And God, we thank you that you can heal us. We thank you, through Jesus, you can heal us. Would you be with these children as they go back to school, Lord, and as they grow up? Would you help them to understand who you are and bring them up in your way? And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Boys and girls, do you want to stand up and we'll sing from here? Yeah? Yeah? We're going to sing a song that I remember singing when I was your age. "He Made the Stars to Shine." Now, I know there's some actions to this. Do you know them? No? I'll try and do them, but I've only got one hand, so imagine doing them with two hands. Yeah? Adults, you can help as well, because I'm sure you know the actions. But we'll stand and sing. Let's stand and sing, He Made the Stars to Shine. Job. Boys and girls, thank you. You can head back to your seats. We're going to read from God's Word. We're going to read from the Scriptures. Our reading today is found in Mark chapter 10. In the New Testament, boys and girls, if you want to, you can read along. That would be amazing. We're going to be in Mark chapter 10, so it's Matthew, Mark. It's the second book in the New Testament, and it's the big number 10. And we're going to read from verse 46. That's the small number, 46, right until the end. And it's that story in the Bible that we've just spoke about. Mark chapter 10, verses 46, Jesus heals blind Bartimaeus. And they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, Call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, Take heart, get up, he is calling you. And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, What do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, Go your way. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. And we pray that the Lord would bless this reading to us. If the congregation could remain seated, we are going to have our offering for today, and we're going to sing the item of praise, Lord, I come before your throne of grace. Thank you. Father God, we thank you that you are a faithful God, even to an unfaithful people. We thank you for the blessings you give us each day, Lord, and especially at this moment, the financial blessings that we have, Lord. Compared to so many others around the world, we are so blessed. Father God, we thank you for what you give us, Lord, and we pray that you would take what you've given us, Lord, and you would take it for your work, Lord. That this offering that's received today would be used in the advancement of your kingdom here in Portrush and further afield. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Boys and girls, do you want to head out to children's church? Yeah? Good job. Just while the boys and girls are heading out, I don't believe it's coincidence, but one of the things I would love to pray for today is, I can call her a friend now, a friend, Catherine, who's the E3 schools worker up here for SUNI. The work that I meet with Catherine every so often, and the work she's been doing in and amongst the schools here is incredible. So we're going to be praying for her today. And I seen that there was on the announcements, there was a coffee morning in support of her. So if you are able to make it to that coffee morning, please do. Please chat there. And if not, please continue to pray for her. We're also going to be praying for the ongoing war. It's sort of left our view, I suppose, or left our rear view mirror, the ongoing war in Ukraine and just what's going on there, Lord, going on. And we're going to ask the Lord for his peace work or peace-giving work to be done there. And the fact that the church would thrive in amongst that. Let's pray. Let's pray for those things. Father God, we thank you so much that you're a God who listens to us, that we can know and trust that you're with us. Thank you that you're a God who loves us. God, we think about this local place here, Lord. We think about Portrush here. We thank you that that the congregation here have got leave to call, Lord. And Father, just as that process continues along on, Lord, we pray that you would be working, Lord. Pray that you would be stirring up the heart of someone who would come to minister here, Lord. Pray that he would sense a strong calling to this congregation, Lord. A strong calling, not only to the congregation, but to the surrounding area, Lord. God, we pray for the session here as they make decisions, Lord. We pray for the Linkage Commission as they navigate, Lord. We thank you and we pray for John as he convenes here in this time of supposed uncertainty, Lord. God, as you bring someone here, would you bring someone with gifts and talents that will be able to complement this congregation here, Lord? Would you bring someone who would be able to get on well with the Kirk session, Lord? Pray that you would bring someone who would be a faithful follower of you, Lord. Someone who values their time in devotion and prayer, in personal prayer, just as much as they value their work, Lord. Father, prepare their heart. And give them a burning desire to see Portrush changed. Father God, we thank you for the work that's been carried out here in the past week, Lord. We thank you for the outreach. Thank you that I've experienced it, Lord, last year. Of seeing a church ready to welcome people in through their doors and to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we just pray for each person who a member of this congregation came into contact with this week, Lord. Pray that the conversations they had will have stirred up something in their heart, Lord. Pray that they would know that you are a forgiving God. But you're a God who does require change, Lord. Pray that they would know that you're a God who, when we follow, it's for our good and for your glory, Lord. Father, we thank you for this church, Lord. We thank you for where it's placed so prominent in Main Street, Lord. And God, we just pray that you would continue to use it as an outreach post, as a beacon of hope in what may be a very dark community. And as people come up here for physical rest away from work and from their everyday lives, Lord, we pray that in this congregation and the other congregations in Port Rush, they would find a spiritual rest. They would find something totally different to what they've experienced before. And we pray that people would come to know you as their Lord and Savior. God, we pray for the guys who are away at Castle Wellham. Thank you that you called us to be, not only to come away from sin and you saved us, Lord, but you saved us for yourself and for your church. Lord, we thank you that church is not a human idea, that it was a Jesus idea, that you called, that he called us to bear with one another, Lord. Father, as we as church, as it's described in the Bible, are like a body, Lord, with different gifts and different talents, Lord, would that be recognized here, Lord? Father, we pray for the guys in Castlewell and pray that they will have had a good weekend. Pray that they will have been able to delve deeper into your word and we've been able to understand more about a little bit more about who you are and what you've done for them, Lord. God, we just ask that you would revive them and restore them this weekend. And as they go back to their normal lives of school and work, Lord, we pray that there would be a burning desire to see church go forth. Father God, we pray for any illnesses or deaths in this congregation, Lord. Pray for anyone who is sick, who is in hospital, who is unable to make it out, or who is out and is feeling awful, Lord. We pray for them. Pray that you would bring healing to them, Lord. Pray that you would restore them back to them, their normal selves, Lord. Father, for anyone who is grieving, we pray for them. Pray that you would come close to them, you would comfort them, that they would know the peace that passes all understanding. And they would know that even in the darkest of times, you bring hope. Even in the most horrendous of circumstances, you bring light. We thank you for those words in John. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome. Thank you that we know you as our Lord and Savior, that we can face these trials, these moments of darkness, knowing that you are the light of the world and that you have brought light to us. Father God, we thank you for Catherine. Lord, we pray for her, Lord. Pray for this girl who came up the university here in Coleraine and fell in love with the North Coast so much that she sought after a job here, Lord. We thank you for the calling on her life to go into schools and to teach the good news of Jesus Christ, Lord. We thank you that she is Bible believing, Lord. We thank you that she is seeking a personal relationship with you, Lord. And we thank you that she can connect with young people and children and adults in an incredible way, Lord. We just pray for her. Pray that you would give her time to rest, Lord, that you would help her to find moments of quietness in amongst a very busy schedule, Lord. We pray that you would open up doors in schools where she hasn't been before, Lord. We pray that you would help her to be able to navigate what is becoming a very difficult, which are becoming very difficult circumstances in schools, Lord, and with education, Lord. We pray for Eshi and I. Pray for the support that they give her, Lord. And we just ask that you would supply her every need, whether that's social or physical or financial, Lord. Would you supply the needs for her to be able to continue on this work? We thank you for the work of the E3 Schools Project, Lord. And we pray that it would bring understanding to young people and you'd be raising up a generation of young people who love you. Finally, God, thinking further afield than Northern Ireland, Lord, we understand that there is war going on, Lord, and yet it seems so far away. We understand that the war was never part of that original creation, Lord, that there was peace. And because sin entered the world through us, we have war and we have death. God, years after this war started, Lord, we want to pray especially for the churches in Russia and Ukraine, Lord. for churches who know you, Lord, and know the destructiveness of what's going on, Lord. Pray that you would help them to thrive in such a hard environment, Lord. Pray that you would bring people to the church, Lord, seeking help, seeking refuge. And Father, we pray that they would find refuge in you. They would find the forgiveness of sins. And they would find a love that is greater than any love that this world has ever known. God, we pray for peace in Ukraine and in Russia, Lord. We pray for fighting to stop. And we pray that for those who are in the wrong, you would bring justice. And for those who are hurting and grieving, would you bring peace? God, we know that you love us. We know that you hear our prayers. And we pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. What is your favorite Bible story of all time? Some you're going to learn about me today as I do like a wee bit of interaction. What's your favorite Bible story of all time? Someone shout it out. Not very Presbyterian, but okay. What do we think? Go on, please. The prodigal son. Okay, great one. Absolute fantastic Bible story. One that a lot of us, if not all of us, have heard. Anyone else? David and Goliath, I was waiting for that one. One of my favorites. It seems to be that I always end up being Goliath in, you know, children's addresses. Can't imagine why, but it has brought on some spectacular falls. So it has. David and Goliath, a story which is about a king, a chosen king, a shepherd who goes and defeats the giant. Sounds a bit familiar, doesn't it? Anything else? Okay, I'll start a few. What about the colorful coat, Joseph? Anyone got Joseph? I remember doing it in schism. Yeah, we do. We love Joseph. Jonah and the whale. Yeah, disobedient. And he doesn't get his own way. What about Abraham and Sarah? Anyone love that story? Of a couple who are far too old to have a baby, but God promised them and God seen that promise through. He had a plan for them, and he's seen that plan through. In Northern Ireland, it probably still is, but it's increasingly getting less. We have a population that if you asked them that question, they would be at least be able to tell you one. We have a population of people who know the stories, who know all the facts. If you put them in front of the BB or GB or the Sunday school quiz, they would know enough to get them through and probably win the quiz by pulling out spaghetti from a pot. Some of the stories we think about are of giants or lions. There's another one, Daniel in the lion's den. Stories of giants falling, of lions' mouths being shut, of boats, of giant boats which would save and bring forth a new people, of rainbows, of fire. Some's about God showing up in these magnificent ways of parting seas, of leading people with fire and smoke. But the one people would talk about most is probably Jesus' birth. They hear it every year, the Christmas story. Or maybe it's Jesus' death. Or maybe for the ones who really know their Bible, it would be turning water into wine. What about the first Bible story you ever heard? Can you think back to it? Can you remember it? I was really blessed as a child growing up to be brought up in a Christian family. I grew up with my dad reading the Bible to me and praying with me at night. I grew up with my mum strumming on the guitar, playing songs and singing choruses with me, amazed that she could play by ear. I was brought to church, to a church which was an aging congregation but was filled with spiritual grandparents. I look at my life as I was growing up, and from a very young age, it was modeled to me that church was more than just a Sunday thing. It was an everyday thing, mostly because mum and dad couldn't get a babysitter to have to take me and when they led stuff. But I was brought to the kid stuff. I was brought to the adult stuff. And one of these adult things was a thing called the woman's circle. It wasn't a PW, as Mum likes to very much highlight to me. It was simply to get people to come in and to be with one another. A church on the Donegal Road, just outside the village area, the woman's circle happened in their halls. And there's a story that Mum likes to tell of me at 3 years old getting up and being able to recite the story of Bartimaeus. Now, I am not that intelligent. I'm just persistent. Every night, my dad had to read the exact same story again and again and again and again. I wouldn't let him read any other. It was always blind Bartimaeus, blind Bartimaeus, blind Bartimaeus. Why? I have no idea. Maybe it's so I could write this sermon. I have no idea. But I love the story. Or maybe it's because we see the healing work of Jesus, both physical and spiritual. And even as a child, really, really young, I knew what was needed. These stories from our childhood, of these great Bible stories, we sometimes get them mixed up. Even us Christians get them mixed up with the other stories we hear of Jack and the Beanstalk, Incy Wincy Spider, Three Little Pigs. And when we hit the age, 9, 10, 11, and we start to go to high school, it's sometimes like these just get put in the same category. Not intentionally. It's not that we disregard or we think that we don't believe anymore. It just, they get put in that same category and they're not for us anymore. Sometimes we feel like we're getting older and it's we get a better understanding and we start to read those more difficult passages and it commemorates or commend anyone who's read Leviticus. We start to read those more difficult passages and yet we forget about these really incredible stories. The Bible tells us that all scripture is God-breathed and is good for teaching, rebuking, and encouraging. The story of Bartimaeus is part of that all scripture. In the story of Bartimaeus, there's a few things we can look at and we can highlight. It'd be helpful if you had your Bible with you and open. For anyone, it's Mark chapter 10, verse 46. The first thing we see is a caring Savior. The story in the book of Mark is set at this incredible landmark. In the narrative of the book of Mark, the story is at the very end of the return journey to Jerusalem. Jesus had been traveling across the land. He'd been ministering to people around him. He had traveled and healed, performed miracles, raised people to life. And for many people who saw these miracles, they were showing who Jesus really was. They were seeing his power and they were thinking that things probably couldn't get any better. For those disciples being able to witness that daily, they were probably thinking, "What? How could we get any more? How could we be more excited?" And who could blame them? Imagine seeing the things that they've seen today here in Port Rush or wherever you find yourselves, of people who we know who are sick, have ailments, being able to be made well and to get up and walk. People who are suffering, having an end put to that suffering. A church lunch where there isn't enough food. Now that never happens. But someone coming and blessing it and 5,000 people being fed with just a few fish and some loaves. If these things were happening, of course we would believe in Jesus. Of course we'd believe in God. Of course we'd be really excited and want to tell people. We might be mistaken to think that. But there was things that happened in the Bible and there were still people who didn't believe, who didn't trust. The truth for the people in Jericho and Jerusalem and in the whole land and the whole world is that this story, the narrative of Jesus' life would get much worse and then would get much better. Jesus wasn't aimlessly walking around the Holy Land. He wasn't just walking and would stumble upon these situations by chance. No, Jesus was making his final walk. He was heading back to Jerusalem for a purpose. He was walking to his death. And he knew this. He knew that what was coming, he knew that he would have to die, because he told his disciples enough that they should have known as well. He had been preparing for this. The people surrounded him. In fact, on three occasions in Mark, between chapter 8, verse 22, and chapter 10, 52, the disciples are told of Jesus' death. Three times in just over two chapters, they're told about Jesus' death. Jesus knew where he was going. He knew what was coming, and yet he stopped. In the middle of the hustle, bustle, busy crowd, he stopped and turned around to the blind man and called him to himself. Jesus is the caring Savior. That's the first character that we see in this story. The second character is the crowd. Jericho at this time was packed. It was packed to the gills. It's the oldest city to continually be inhabited by a people. It, at the worst of times, was filled with hustle and bustle. And it's not like here in Port Rush and Port Stewart, where 4 months of the year it's packed, and then come November, the place is dead and all shops close at 2 o'clock. It's not like that at all. It was always on the go. Jericho was the ancient city that never slept. Imagine being there. Imagine what we experience here this week, but times it by 100. And if you know the story of the Gospels, there was a reason that the death of Jesus took place in Jerusalem. There is a reason why Jesus' death took place in Jerusalem. Later on in the Bible, Paul records this part of Scripture. I want to read it to you. It's read out at our communion services. For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it. Do it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Paul is going back to that Last Supper. He's taking a journey back, reminding the disciples of that time, the church of that time, of that Last Supper. Jesus was at the Last Supper because it was a Passover meal. It was a meal that the Jews celebrated, being rescued from Egypt, being broken out of slavery, and about being brought into the promised land. Many of the people that Jesus was rubbing shoulders with in Jericho would have known this story. In fact, they would have been on the pilgrimage to Jerusalem. They would have been on their way to that holy city to take part in that exact same festival that the Lord Jesus was taking part in, to remember that saving God. They knew the stories of the Old Testament. And yet, this crowd that physically could see were spiritually blind. They had no idea what was happening. The irony of the story is that the crowd who could see were spiritually blind. They knew that God would save them, but they didn't understand how. They were going to a festival that would mimic the first Passover in Egypt, where a sacrificial lamb would give his blood, its blood, and the blood of the lamb would save them, painted on doorposts so that the angel of death would pass over them. The sacrificial lamb. They knew Jesus, but they knew him as Jesus the Nazarene, the wee boy from the small town who got big by his miracles, his tricks. People who are a lot smarter and who have studied this a lot more than I they've spent their lives studying the Bible, think that this story was set where it is in the book of Mark as one final push to try and get people to understand the real identity and the authority that Jesus has. And the people who were there had no idea. They had no idea what was going on. They did not know Jesus as the saving King, the sacrificial Lamb. One of the most difficult parts of my life in the past number of years has been a friend who I grew up with. This friend, I'm not going to name them, but this friend I grew up with, I knew him from when I was 3. He was in my nursery class, my pre-nursery class. He went through primary school together. When we went to high school, we went to 2 different high schools. But we were still friends. We went to everything in the church together. He was the type of guy who knew everything that was in the Bible. He got to do the narrating every year at the Christmas play. He spent time alone reading his Bible. He spent time with his family reading the Bible. And we were in the same friendship group. We went on holiday together. We lived together in uni for a while. But something in his life changed in those final years of me being friendly with him. His lifestyle changed. And one day when we were chatting about this difference in his lifestyle and that the fact he didn't read his Bible anymore or didn't want to go to church or didn't want to hear anything about Jesus, he said these words, and they are still heart-wrenching today: "I never really believed. I still pray for this guy every day. I pray that he'll remember these stories of giants and of lions and of a saving God, a God who gives second chances. And I pray that he will be given spiritual sight." The greatest threat to society then and today isn't a physical ailment. It's not physical blindness. It's spiritual blindness. We live in a world that is so like Jericho, of people so busy running around like headless chickens. Even ourselves, even church leaders, that they forget that they have to spend time with Jesus. A few verses down the line, we hear a story of a man who had everything. A man who was rich and wealthy. He asked Jesus, what do I have to do to receive eternal life? And Jesus said, sell everything. At the end of it, the thing was, you have to sell everything. And he couldn't do it. He couldn't give up what he had. And so he went away sad. That's what the Bible says. So here we have a crowd that has physical sight but is spiritually blind. And finally, our final character, the star, well, Jesus, star of the show, but certainly the backup, Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus, you will see there if you look in verse 46 there, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus. That word bar is used a bit like Mick is used today in this part of the world, son of. Barabbas, son of the father. Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. Why would it put that in? Why on earth would that be such an important thing for it to be put in the scriptures? It's maybe because the name Timaeus means honor. Son of honor. The honorable place for a man in this day was at the center of the road. If you were a king, you were always placed at the center of the road so everyone could see. And yet this story tells us Bartimaeus is sitting at the side of the road, the place for the dishonorable. There was a common thought that in that day that people who had ailments or blindness or sickness were being punished by God for their own sins or for the sins of their fathers. And so in society back then, this man would have been seen as the lowest of the low, the man who sinned or his fathers had sinned against God. He didn't have loads of money because he couldn't work. He had no servants. He had no nice clothes. Nothing about this man was honorable. from the outside. But if we look at verse 47, the writer is clear to give Jesus the name, or the writer is very clear that Bartimaeus gives Jesus the name, his true name, before it calls Jesus the Nazarene. It's not a mistake, because Bartimaeus, a few verses later, calls Jesus the Son of David. This man who was physically blind was the one who had spiritual sight. Bartimaeus knew the stories of the Old Testament. He knew the promise that was given to David that there would be a savior in his line, one who would be the reigning king, the king that would reign forever and ever without end, and no one would take over him. Bartimaeus recognized Jesus not as a Nazarene, but as the savior, the promised Messiah, and the one who would bring salvation. And his response is to get up and leave everything. You'll see in the scripture it says that he threw his cloak aside. The best description we have for that cloak today is a bit like a guitar case of a busker. Imagine a busker standing in the middle of Portrush and the guitar case is open. People are throwing money in. That's how he's making his living. Bartimaeus' coat would have been his living. That's all he had. That was what he needed to get through the day. That is what he needed to maybe. That is all Bartimaeus had, was in that cloak. And yet when Jesus called him, he got up and he threw it away like it was nothing. Because what was on offer was so much better. He got up, threw his cloak away, and in amongst of people probably asking questions, why does Jesus even want to see him? Sure, he has nothing to offer. Why would Jesus ever want to spend time with him? He runs towards Jesus. That is the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus calls people who have nothing. Nothing to give to him. No time, don't have this power to give to him, because Jesus has all the power. No amount of money would ever want to make Jesus come to someone more than the other. And this blind man running as he bumps into the crowd on, runs to Jesus and falls at his feet. And Jesus asks, what do you want? Bartimaeus calls him rabbi, teacher. Give me my sight. And Jesus replies, go on your way. Your faith has made you well. The end of this story is incredible, and probably the reason I remembered it as I was growing up, because his sight was healed, his physical ailment was healed. But when I start to read it as I get older, mature a wee bit, I realize that the biggest thing that happened that day was that his sins were forgiven. And as I said to the kids, that is on offer to us today. If you know the Lord and Savior as your Lord Jesus as your Savior, then you have been the part of a miracle. Spiritually dead, raised to life. No matter what physical ailments we come up against, no matter what is going on in our lives, we can hold to the fact that we have been forgiven and that there is a destination for us in heaven. At the very end of this chapter, and immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Bartimaeus got up with a new spring in his step, with every reason to go and see the world, things he had never seen before. And yet, Bartimaeus goes and follows Jesus. The story speaks of a caring king, a savior who was on his way to do battle with death, and who won the war. A crowd with sight, a bit like the world around us, thinking they're on the right path, the get-rich-quick path, and they are totally missing the bigger picture. And Bartimaeus willing to throw everything away to run towards Jesus, followed him day by day, week by week, month by month, good times, bad times, and he followed him. Where do you see yourself today? Is it time to give up that meaningless pursuit of what life to the full, what the world tells us life to the full looks like? And to recognize that you are of infinite worth to the Lord? Is it time to reset yourself, to get your priorities right, to look at your life, to readjust its course back to God? Because this call requires action. If we want to do that, we have to put it into action. Can't just be a thought, has to be deed. This story of the gospel recorded here, of Bartimaeus being given sight and following Jesus, it reminds me of the verse, Christians in sport use it, Galatians 2:20, "For through the law I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this story. We thank you for how this points towards a healing God, a saving God, Lord, a God who calls us to follow him, who doesn't need us, and yet chooses to use us in our weakness. God, help us to understand it. Help us to follow you daily. And Father, we pray for that those people in the crowd who might be friends to us, Lord, those who are so spiritually blind and they don't even recognize it, Lord, please give them sight, Lord. Our friends and family who don't believe, give them sight. And Father, bring them back to you. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Our final item of praise is a song that I absolutely love. These are the days of Elijah. It speaks of this return of Jesus Christ, the thing that we as Christians are hoping for and waiting for. I don't know if you've seen what happened there of the young child running towards their father. What an image. If you are a child today and you are need of a father who loves you, a heavenly father, run towards Jesus. Run towards the Father in heaven, and he'll pick you up just as like this earthly father did. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now and evermore. Amen. Thank you.